In life, we have lots of opportunities to make a difference in people's lives. The question is when we choose to make that difference and how we choose to make that difference. Recently, I've gone through a tough time of it. I never expect homelessness would be a part of my life. I'm a college-educated person. I've owned a couple businesses since age 15, and openly, I had a family. I had a townhouse. I had a life that was full of prosperity, in my opinion. It might not have been the richest in the world compared to other people's ideas, but it was exactly right for me and my family. But in truth, when cyberhacking occurs, when technology is removed from our lives, when people lose opportunities because others cannot see them standing before them, it does make a difference in our lives, and it can lead to homelessness. Most people in the world today are really one or two paychecks away from homelessness. They don't realize that because they're working for the day to day. Not everyone is saving money for retirement, and not everyone is putting money away for their elder years and how they're going to handle their life as they get older, as their eyesight starts to fail, and as their body may not function as well, and perhaps even their mind may not function as well as it once did in their prime. What we're really talking about today is how to avoid the problems that come with homelessness, but at the same time, we have to understand the world that we live in today. The world that we live in today does not treat people well. That is absolutely true. I can travel and I can visit places to try and sell one little item just to keep moving in life, just to keep my plan for my life going. And the people there who are supposed to be good Christians, who are supposed to be well-versed in the world, who are supposed to understand how things can happen and identity theft can occur and how people can take over other people's rights and try and do things to them and make decisions for them that's really not their lawful right to do, that we still have those people who, instead of taking the time to talk with someone, get to know someone, will just try and throw a food bag at them or literally just take down their license plate and call police. Now, what kind of a world is that? I don't really know. I visited a lot of churches in the last several weeks, as a matter of fact, over the course of six or seven states, and usually it's the same sort of response, that you walk in, they profess to have all this help for homeless people or for people in poverty, and that's a part of their mantras for their entire organization or the network of churches in which they belong to, and yet when someone homeless shows up on their doorstep, the first thought is, this person is a charlatan. Now, I wonder if that's how Jesus felt when he was traveling through Galilee. That he was literally going pretty much alone. He would pick a few people up along the way and they would travel together. And when they would travel together, they had a little bit more strength in numbers. But openly, he spoke to the masses. He usually had to have a conversation with someone in charge of an organization, probably, to get the opportunity to use that field, or simply just started talking and the people realized that he was someone important and they allowed him to speak. Now, isn't that what life is about? That we can't control every aspect of our people's lives in our life. We can't openly say that a person who's in our church is being fed by our sermons alone. They might be reading other books that we're not in control of deciding for them. They might be purchasing other little aspects of faith that we don't even know that they have. And yet, when a person arrives at your church, you think you have the right to say, I'm sorry, there's no one in these 100 cars that are here in the lot who'd be willing to purchase a $10 book from you. Now, that's a little outlandish. Now, on the one hand, it's outlandish for me to say it. On the other hand, it's outlandish for you not to think about it. Because in reality, when one person comes to the front door and says, gosh, we don't have $10 to our name, and this church holds 700, 800 people, I have to really wonder what the money management is going on for that particular church. Now, does it mean that you should buy something for every single person that comes along and tries to sell something? No. But let's talk about the reality of that. That in this world, everything is being sold. Every single thing, even churches, even the pastors preaching, in order to produce for you, who work at that church, an income in order for you to work there and basically reside in this community, or whatever community you're in. You see, there's always a sale involved. There's always something that's being sold, something that's being profitable, and something that's creating an employment for you. So when people come along and stand in front of you and say, listen, I'm struggling with this particular issue and I'd really appreciate some help because I've got a couple challenges right now, what are you doing to help them problem solve? Are you just sending them on their way as if you have no network? Or are you looking out into the lot of your church and going, how many cars are in that lot? Do you literally have the right to make a decision for someone else and their soul and their beliefs and their ideas about what God is calling them to do for someone else? And the answer probably is no. You see, this is where we make the mistakes. This is where we make mistakes in prayer groups too. A lot of churches have prayer lists, where people who have difficulties going on in life get that information shared either publicly or privately with someone in that prayer chain. My mom used to call it the dingling tree with her church, but basically what they would do is that they would create relationship by one person would call the next person, give them, pass the message along, and they would just pass it all the way down through the tree so that everybody got to know what the prayer was about. But usually those trees are only about 20 people. But in a church that has 700, 800 people, that probably most of them are somehow connected to technology, whether it be through text messages, or through internet, just think how much more powerful that prayer could be if literally that prayer was sent to 700 to 800 people, giving them the right to decide whether or not they were going to say a little bitty prayer for whatever was going on in that person's life. You see, the power of prayer is in the numbers of people who pray. The power of the ability to take action and handle injustices in the world is really allowing people to decide whether or not they want to participate in helping someone. You see, that's really what we're talking about. Now, to say that there isn't petty cash of $10 in a bank or in a accounting office somewhere is probably silly. To say that within a parking lot that's full of 100 cars, that there isn't one person out of 100 who'd be willing to purchase a book for $10 is a little outlandish. You see, we never know the hearts, minds, and souls of another human being. But what we can do is open the doors for people an opportunity so that the people who are struggling have a chance to meet the people who understand struggle, who are willing to help them in that struggle, and willing to help them get out of the challenge they're in. You see, even in my own life, I have family who allowed me to be homeless for 14 months. They would sometimes leave me a message of, do I have food? But it was more a slap in the face to me than it was a help. Because if they really cared whether or not I had food, they might say, hey, we have a safe driveway. Would you like to park your car in it? But even I can't do that because they won't stay out of my car. And right now, you have to understand how violent people are to homeless people. I literally go and find a place to park that's safe, and then there's always somebody who thinks they have the right to put their hand in through an open window that allows me to breathe at night, open up my car and take something that they want to take, or put something in my car that they want to put in. I literally wake up and find dirt and soot all over my carpets. I keep my car as clean as I possibly can. I don't like finding soot in my bags and in my papers. But that's just me. Now, does it make it difficult to go into churches? Sometimes it does. Why? Because maybe not everyone has a chance to have an opportunity in life. I recently went to a church and they were kind enough to allow me to use their shop back so I could try and clean up my car a little bit. And that was a great kindness. But when you go into a church and they automatically want to give you a bag of food, they're not thinking of the very important question, is whether or not the food in that bag they're about to give out actually matches the body of the person that they're trying to give it to. So there's always a better way to do things. There's always a better way to streamline things. And more importantly, aren't they trying to create relationships with people in the community? Wouldn't it be better to say, hey, I've got a couple minutes. Would you like to sit down and have a soda with me or have a beverage or have something and just have a chat about what's going on with you and I'll tell you about me and we'll see if there's anything we can do or anybody in the church who might be able to help you. See, that's how you're representing a church. If you're just representing one pastor, that's one man. And sure, one man or one woman as a pastor might represent an entire organization. But that one person might feel that they have the right to decide the educational curriculum of every person in that church, but I think most of the adults in that church might disagree. They might have chosen the church for a particular philosophy, for a particular bent, for a particular reason, that their children love it or something like that. But in the end, every human being has the right to decide what they're going to read, what they're going to learn about, what they're going to hear about, what they're going to do in their life, and who they're going to help. Now, this has been Blake Gensen of Blaze Communications, LLC, traveling, roaming, a roaming reporter of sorts, experiencing what it's like for people who are looking for a new place to be, looking for new opportunities in life, looking for how to keep going after struggles, after cyber hacking, after all sorts of chaos, litigation abuse, emotional abuse, physical abuse, possibly. But we won't go there in these stories. That's too private for most people to even grasp. But the reality is that financial abuse is just as bad. But when you open a locked door that doesn't belong to you, when you take down license plates that aren't yours to take down with the intent to harm someone, with the intent to call police, you are literally putting a legal notice on someone's name that's not your lawful right to do. If all the person did was say, I'd like to sell you a book. You see, because what you're doing in life is selling someone too. You're selling them on your church. You're selling them on you. And more importantly, you're representing your job.